will profile the city's Holocaust survivors all year long.
10 News reporter Jared Ahrens is in the Live Center now. Jared, the people behind this exhibit say it is more important than ever to tell these stories.
Yeah, Jim, Virginia, there were 12 known Holocaust survivors in Chula Vista. Only 5 are still alive. And as that generation passes, the people behind this exhibit say, if we don't learn from history, we risk repeating it.
This has been a labor of love. I've loved every second of it.
Sandra Scheller's exhibit at the Chula Vista Library,
Ruth, Remember Us the Holocaust,
is deeply personal.
These are the scars. My mother's, my grandfather's, my grandmother's.
Her mother, Ruth, survived 3 concentration camps and came to Chula Vista. Sharing her message with kids became a passion for mother and daughter.
And the idea was to come in and pick her up in the morning, have her do a school, do her errands, and she felt really proud. I think the most important thing is that she felt proud.
Ruth passed in 2018. At the time, she and Sandra had already been working on the exhibit.
But these are them: Paul Schauder, Ruth Sachs, Kurt Sachs.
It profiles the dozen Holocaust survivors that called Chula Vista home after World War II.
Ursula Zrelski, Sid Wapner, and Ona Pufi.
Telling their stories of survival and how they made a life in the South Bend.
Max Weinstock had 7 stores. We had economy furniture, Sid's fabric.
The exhibit is full of photos, items from Jewish life in Europe and Chula Vista, and a few personal details from Sandra's family.
My grandmother had to break a tooth out because it had some gold in it. They would have killed her for this gold.
Scheller says her mother would be proud that everyone in the South Bay can now learn from what happened to her.
I get messages from my mom. You know, a case won't work and this won't work, and all of a sudden, wait, why did that work right now? Thankful.
Hello, I'm Sandy Scheller with the South Bay Historical Society and the Chula Vista Heritage Museum. I wanted to talk to you about Ruth, Remember Us the Holocaust. Who is Ruth? Well, Ruth just happened to be my mother, a Holocaust survivor. She survived 3 camps, including Auschwitz, faced Dr. Mengele 6 times, used kettle waters in the concentration camp in Theresien to take a bath on Friday that nobody knew about. This is just one of the many stories of our Holocaust survivors. And I have featured 13 of these Holocaust survivors who I realized came to the South Bay of San Diego. My mom loved Chula Vista. She was a resident for over 60 years and made it a point to go to the different classrooms and talk about her Holocaust experiences. What started her talking was when she went back to a concentration camp 50 years later, she bumped into my grandmother's friend. And the friend went to my mother and said, by the way, Ruth, I have the dress that your mother wore in the concentration camp. I knew one day you'd be coming back to pick it up. And this is what started everything. My mom talked to a friend who was a school teacher and showed her the dress. Next thing you know, the school teacher had her come into the classroom, and it became almost like an infection going from one class to the other class to the other class. So my mom made it a point to talk in the different classrooms almost 10 days before she passed away. It was the 18th of December that we were here in the Chula Vista Public Library talking about what we wanted to do in the exhibit. And then she passed away on the 29th of December, 2018.
Okay, tell me the story.
The story is I got it from my grandmother, my father's side, a small ring.
Okay, you got a
initial,
small ring from
initials.
Your grandmother and grandfather.
A gold ring.
A gold ring.
And I loved it. And in Auschwitz, I had to drop it into the bucket.
You took it with you to Theresienstadt.
And I hid it.
You hid it in Theresienstadt. But when you got to Auschwitz,
they took it away because they shaved me. I had it in my hair.
You had the ring in your hair, and then when they shaved your hair,
they found the ring.
They found the ring. Did they find it, or did you say, wait, let me drop this in the bucket?
I don't remember anymore. It was so fast.
But you tied a ring.
Wonderful. Even to me.
Mama, you have to tie the ring. You tied the ring in your hair?
Yeah, underneath.
I'd like to tell you a little more about the different Holocaust survivors.
I'm Solomon Schlosser. I survived the Holocaust and I'm 96 years old. I hope to be a few years more in my life.
Solomon Schlosser was a Holocaust survivor from Lutz, Poland. And he was a very young boy when he was in the ghetto of Lutz, and he ended up going to Auschwitz. He was in other camps, but he did go to Auschwitz. And while he was in Auschwitz, I remember him telling me a story about his last name, Schlosser, which means locksmith. But by then, he was known as a number. And the Nazis said to him, "Ich brauche eine Schlosser." I need a locksmith. And without any hesitation, this 19-year-old boy said, "Ich bin ein Schlosser." And the Nazis thought that he was making fun of them, because how could you be 19 years old and be a locksmith? Poor Solomon was in the frozen ice with no shoes, having to roll these balls of ammunition when the Nazi, his guard, came to him and said, "Why did you make fun of us?" And Solomon said, "I didn't. I heard you talk about a Schlosser, and I thought you were talking about me." And the Nazi says, "You don't have a name. You only have a number." Well, interesting with Solomon, he ended up working as a dishwasher for the Nazis. So maybe he was able to find a few scraps extra to eat. And he survived that way.
And that is the Schlesers in the Deutsch.
Yes, but what happened with the...
So I said, I was thinking they called my name.
And you thought that they drew his name.
So I Schleser.
They said, oh.
Who is a Schleser? I said, they asked me, how long you Schleser? I said, 19 years.
All right, so let me say it and see if I'm right. For some reason, they were looking for a locksmith, right? For somebody with keys, that does keys. So they asked, who's a Schlosser? And you said, me.
I'm a Schlosser.
How long have you been a Schlosser? You said, 19 years. So he said, oh, you're joking, you're making fun of me. And he was upset. So he threw you into a ditch. So you were there for how long in the ditch doing this thing?
Maybe 20 minutes.
And then afterwards, he got you
out. 20 minutes?
Yeah, okay, out of the hole. And then he asked you, why did you tell me you were a Schlosser?
I said, that's my name.
And you said, because that's my name.
He said, "And 199, you will be my shoe boy."
You will be my shoe shine boy?
Boy.
And he called you by your number. He
said,
He said, 907, you're my shoe shine boy.
That's it.
Lily Hecht, an amazing woman who was in the concentration camps with her mother. And Lily remembered standing with her mother in the gas chamber. She was supposed to be gassed. And all of a sudden, they got out of the gas chamber. And Lily's mother made a joke that maybe they didn't pay the gas bill that day. Lily used a sense of humor to survive the concentration camps.
I am Lily Hecht, Holocaust survivor.
Leave all your clothes. They were people.
She removed all of her clothes.
Toda tu ropa. Yo nunca vi a mi mamá desnuda.
She never saw her mother naked.
naked. My mother said the same thing. What she's saying is exactly what my mother said, just so you know. So you see your mother naked, and you're taking off all your clothes.
Todos dicen lo mismo.
Sí, dice que su mamá dijo lo mismo. En ese momento, ¿dónde estaba tu papá?
Ya no supimos de él.
¿No lo vieron? She didn't see her father. That's the, I think, the most important thing. Cuando llegaron, ¿en algún momento le dijiste adiós a tu papá? She never could say goodbye to her father.
Was he killed in Auschwitz?
Yeah.
Mark Fischoff, a very prominent man in Chula Vista. If you've ever been to 3rd and K Street, you might have noticed economy furniture. Mark had a number, because he was in Auschwitz. He lost an eye in Auschwitz because he went in and out of Auschwitz. Somehow he escaped. And then I think on the second or third time, he lost an eye.
I don't know what camp they went to.
They went to, again, it was Auschwitz, it was Dachau. There's one that starts with an L. Is there anything that starts with an L?
Lutz. It's the one in Poland.
Possibly. I don't have that entirety,
okay.
But he was an escaper. He tried to find his way out and then was captured a number of times. Somewhere in between, he lost an eye. I don't know exactly what happened. I kind of recall that it was something, I don't have the exact, I said, well, something hit him in the eye, or he got some type of disease. I really don't remember, but I know he had a glass eye because, you know, and I would say, yes, somewhere in the time that he was involved in the concentration camp, that he was in the concentration camp.
My father, Kurt Sachs, he was 16 years old when the Nazis invaded Austria. And from Austria, he had no place to go. And he also knew that he couldn't go to school. He couldn't continue his education. So he went to Northern Italy. And it was in Northern Italy that he wrote letters to different people with the last name of Sachs, hoping to have them distributed in the United States. He was waiting at a boat dock. And lo and behold, somebody answered one of his letters saying, I'm not related to you, I'm not a Sachs, but this particular letter came to a church and we want to help you. So my father came to Anderson, South Carolina. While he was in Anderson, South Carolina, somebody told him that there's a great place in California. It's like paradise, absolute paradise. So he came to San Diego, California. And then because of him playing the accordion so much, going to Mexico, he made it a point to discover Chula Vista. And that's the story of my father. I wrote a book, Try to Remember, Never Forget. And in the book, one of the things that my mother forgot to tell me was, how did my mother and father reunite? So I'd like to share that story with you now. In one of the cases, you'll notice that there's a letter from my father and a letter from my mother. It was one of the first correspondence letters that they wrote to each other. They wrote 1,500 letters. If you were to take an 11-inch piece of paper, multiply that by 1,500, you'd have a half a mile of love letters. My mother was 7 and my father was 13 when they met. My father was studying for his bar mitzvah, and they were distant, distant, distant cousins. My father came from Austria to Czechoslovakia, and little Ruthie would tease Kurt, and if she wasn't boxing him, she was kissing him. And they would always get in trouble together. They would run downstairs to an ice cream store. Mind you, she was only 7 years old and he was 13. By the time that my mother was 10, my father was 16, and my father had to escape Austria. So she lost contact with my father. Now, by the age of 10, she was told she had to wear a star. By the time that my mother went into the concentration camp, she was one of the first ones in 1941. She got out in 1945. 1946, my mother was out of the concentration camp and she was on a train. And what happened was my mother heard two people speaking English. And as she started talking with them, because my mother was studying English, she said, "Oh, I have a distant cousin in United States. Where are you from?" And the women said, "We're from New York." And my mother said, "Oh, that's where my cousin is, in New York. Do you happen to know a Rudy Kurtz? He's a doctor." And the women said, "Yes, he's our doctor." So my mother insisted, is it possible for her to write a letter that they can hand to Rudy at their convenience, and letting her know that she survived the concentration camp, which they agreed. Well, a few months later, she gets this letter from my father, from Kurt. What happened was, my father, who was here in San Diego, was invited to go to Uncle Rudy's birthday party in New York. And my father saw this letter with a picture from my mother on the table. And he took the address and wrote the letter. And that's how my mother and father reconnected. The funny story is, at the time that my mother was 7, she was a lot shorter than my father, who was 13. So imagine when my father asked my mother to get married, she agreed. He goes to Europe to pick her up. And lo and behold, my mother is taller than my father. And she looked at him and she said, "Oh, Kurt, you're so much shorter than me." But they were married 63 years before he passed away. And as my mother would tell you, she only had one honeymoon, one long 63-year honeymoon. Max Weinstock was a very righteous person here in Chula Vista and had very close ties to people in Israel. His love for Israel was really infectious, and he came from Poland. He was not allowed to emigrate right away to the United States, so he went to Tampico, Mexico. And I really love Max's story.
This is your grandmother, your father's mother.
Mother. Miriam.
Disappeared. Miriam.
Uh-huh. She disappeared. They came home and she was gone. And they just found...
And do you have an idea what... This was after Max left?
After Max was already in Mexico. And my father felt very, very guilty about not getting his mother out. And he would not discuss his mother. I found a picture of his mother, and when I showed it to him, he said, "Don't ever show me that again." He just lived with the guilt.
Why do you think he didn't want to see it again?
He felt very guilty that he did not save her from the concentration camp. People would help him, you know, financially. And he told me the story that one guy gave him pens to sell. He sold pens. He peddled them. And one guy had a whole warehouse full of shoes. And they were all mismatched. And he made pairs out of the shoes. And then he'd go to different neighborhoods and sell them. He would paint them so that it looked like it was a pair, even though it wasn't. And I said, "Daddy, what would happen if they would find out it was not a pair?" And he said, "I never went to the same neighborhood twice."
Max Weinstock was a very prominent person in Chula Vista. In fact, he was very prominent almost all over the world. And his love for Israel was really incredible. In fact, he was one of the founders of Temple Beth Shalom, one of the first synagogues in Chula Vista. Max had a furniture store. I don't know if you all remember Union Furniture. And I think they had 7 or 8 stores. Bella Mark and his twin brother Daniel were in Hungary. And from Hungary, they ended up going into Buchenwald. Now, I believe that they were both soldiers, so they went into the camp as political prisoners, not for being Jewish. Bella would tell me stories that were just unbelievable, because you would sleep at night, and when you woke up, you were waking up with people that had passed. The other thing Bella told me was that the white powder that they put on you was absolutely horrific to try to kill lice. Bella Mark is still with us today. His brother passed away, and to me, Bella is one of my heroes.
Nothing to eat. People sleeping on top, dead people, sick people. I used to sleep outside. I couldn't even go in. Nothing but sick people and dead people.
How old were you, Bella?
23, 24, something like that. And everybody had flecked typhus. The powder, they spray our clothes.
They spray clothes?
Because we are full of bugs, full of lice. Oh, my God. But the SS and Gestapo, they were Hitler's people. Killers.
Yes. Killers, yeah.
They were killers.
Yeah. When the camp was liberated, did they give you food then? Did they feed you? When the Americans came, did they feed you?
Oh, yeah, they feed us, but we cannot eat. We couldn't eat.
Why? Why couldn't you eat?
Typhus.
Typhus.
Oh, gee.
Typhus.
Were you sick?
Oh, yeah. They made hospitals and make hospitals in schools.
Did you go to the hospital?
Huh?
Did you go to the hospital?
Yeah, to be 60 days and I don't know how many days till the fever goes away. Oh.
Until the fever went away. What about Daniel? Was Daniel also in the hospital?
Yeah, everybody.
But
everybody,
you and Daniel were together in the hospital.
Yeah, everybody was there.
But you couldn't eat because you were so sick?
Mm.
You could not eat because you
were
sick?
They wouldn't give you to eat. They didn't give you water.
They wouldn't give you just water?
Because you had to. If they gave you too much food, you would get sick.
People. Nothing but young people.
Nothing but young people?
They used to have
organs. Yeah, because they're probably the only ones that could survive all of that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it takes. It takes some weeks and months to get used to it again.
Bella, can I ask you, do you think about it now? You don't have like a nightmare or a dream or anything?
No. I don't even think about it.
Yeah, you don't even think about it.
In 1939, a 10-year-old boy by the name of Zundel Wapner, you might know him as Sid Wapner because of Sid's fabric on 3rd and Moss. Well, he was 10 years old, and imagine watching the great temple in Poland burning in Białystok. By the time he was 12 years old, Białystok became the Białystok ghetto, and all Jews had to wear yellow stars on their clothing, and most of their personal possessions were taken away. In 1943, the Wapner family received orders to go to a train station from the ghetto. And at the train station, Zundel and his father were now separated from his mother and his sister. It was the last time that he saw his mother and his sister. Zundel and his father were then transported to Majazek concentration camp, and they were taken there for a short time. Zundel and his father, Aaron, were transferred to a concentration camp where they made clothing because the father was a tailor. Zundel and his father, Aaron, were transported to another camp where they made clothing, Nazi clothing, in a factory sometime between 1943 and 1944. Sid's father died of starvation at Blizen camp. Zundel was then transported from Blizen to Auschwitz, and in August of 1944, he was tattooed with the number B2676. He endured physical abuse and a starvation diet. By the time that he was 15 years old, he had lost both his parents and his sister. On November 17, 1944, Zindel was transported to Dachau, a concentration camp that was in Germany. After the war, Zindel was placed in Bergen-Belsen, which was a displaced persons camp, where he was looking for his family and to find any other survivors. In 1949, Zindel boarded the USS Muir to make a trip to the United States. He landed at Ellis Island, and from there he was on his way to Seattle. He learned English and proudly became a United States citizen. In 1952, Zindel was drafted in the United States Army and traveled back to Germany, where he worked as an interpreter. He then came back in 1954, where he returned to Seattle. Sid met his wife, who was born in Romania, in Seattle. In 1957, they married and they headed south. They discovered Chula Vista. At the time, they had a fabric store, which was San Ysidro fabric, and he had built his clientele, moving a little bit up north in Chula Vista, which was Sid's fabric, where he gave the most wonderful personal expertise and best customer service. Sid loved his family. He had two children, Paul and Aaron, and between his synagogue, his business, his love for America, he never forgot that he was a Holocaust survivor. One of my favorite stories is Werner Dreyfus. Actually, I think this should be made into a movie. Imagine you're in Germany with your mother, and then all of a sudden, you're placed in an orphanage. From there, he ended up going to France, and from France, he went to New York, and from New York to Los Angeles. Another part of the story. Mr. and Mrs. Shapoff, prominent Jewish family in Chula Vista, their son was playing baseball and unfortunately died because of the way that he was hit. One of the family members told Sam and Leah to go to an orphanage to pick up a child because they really missed not having one. Well, as you can imagine, they picked Werner Dreyfus. And Werner came back to Chula Vista, where he went to Chula Vista High School. And he had quite a wonderful life because his father was a cattleman, had horses, and lived right there in the bottom of like C Street and over to the Sweetwater River. It was a huge, huge plot of land. Eventually, Werner went to school. He met Norma, and they had their firstborn son. And guess what they named their son? Joel. After the loss of the son that Leah and Sam had.
At that time, I was 8 years old.
8 years old. What happened in 1939?
In 1939, after Kristallnacht, just to go back one step, my mother put me in an orphanage in Frankfurt because she couldn't take care of me, and she felt that maybe by being in the orphanage, I would be able to escape Germany, which she wasn't able to provide for me. So that's how I wound up in Waisenhaus. I don't remember how old I was.
Let me ask you, what happened to your mother and what happened to your father?
We found some records of my mother being sent to Poland to a concentration camp.
Which concentration camp?
I don't know.
You don't know, but you know that she was sent to a concentration camp.
We found some records. And
your father?
I never knew what happened with him.
You never knew.
No.
All of a sudden, your mother puts you in an orphanage.
36, 37.
Being in an orphanage, did you know about Kristallnacht? Did anybody talk to you about it?
No.
No,
that
not at all.
Afterwards.
Oh, of course. And what about what happened in the transport, kinder transport?
Well, the thing, like we're saying, the kids were sent to different places in the world. because not everybody could take all the kids. There was probably 80, 90 children at Waisenhaus. So in 1939, they sent the 22 children were able to go, girls were able to go to Holland. Some went to Israel, and I was among 15 that went to France.
What was that like, Werner? What is it like being in an orphanage?
Well, I can say this, there was no problem at the orphanage. I mean, it was a pleasant experience.
How old were you when you transported from Paris to Los Angeles?
Well, when the Germans invaded Paris to France, we were evacuated down to Limoges.
From Paris, you're going south because the Germans are invading. And what happened?
Everybody was fleeing Paris. And it's just simply amazing how this OSE organization was able to get space on the train for hundreds of kids and transportation to the train station, because the roads were so blocked with people fleeing.
Mm-hmm.
It was a miracle in its own. And the thing with Ernest Papanek, to bring you up to date, he was in charge of all the homes in France that the OSE operated.
Hmm.
And he was on the Germany's most wanted list.
Really?
Yep.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
He was on Germany's most wanted list. When this book came out, you realized your picture was in the book.
No, I didn't know that.
You didn't know. All of a sudden you looked and you went, oh my gosh, that's me.
Yeah.
Amazing. And yeah, this is a New York Times, you know, World Monroe Publishing. I mean, it's an amazing book, a pointed account of how eminent educator helped save Jewish children from the Hitler onslaught. But imagine a woman and her husband who have a son. He is 11 years old. Now, this is a woman in Chula Vista, and the people we're talking about is Sam and Leah Shapoff. Imagine you've got a 10-year-old son. He's playing baseball and he got injured, correct? How did he get injured?
A ball hit him on the ankle.
A ball hits him on the ankle.
A hard ball. When they were playing, somebody hit it and it hit him, and it got infected, and they tried to listen to it.
The ankle got infected, and unfortunately, he dies. His name is Joel.
Joel. He was 12 years old.
12 years old. Devastating for the Shapoff family from Chula Vista. Now what happens is she goes to an orphanage.
Oh, no, better go back up a little bit.
Okay.
Leah Shapoff had a brother, Nady Adelson,
uh-huh,
who was a rabbi, well-known rabbi in Los Angeles.
Okay.
And I think he was the one that mentioned it. Somebody suggested that they bring another child into their house.
Into their home. So somebody said, you know, Leah and Sam, you really need to bring another child.
And so they came up to visit Alma, and that's a whole other story.
Okay, are you ready for this? And this is the child that they adopted. You were how old when you came to Chula Vista?
12 years old.
12 years old from in a home, in an orphanage in Los Angeles. After everything you've been through, you now meet Leah and Sam. Was it love at first sight when you met them?
No, it's kind of a touchy story.
Okay.
You know, they could take out the children for a weekend, you know, they got along well in this, anyway. And they brought me back to the home.
They brought you back?
Back, and they decided they weren't gonna take me.
That they weren't gonna take you. Oh, Werner. And then what happened?
And they dropped me off, and I didn't even know that, because I started to cry. And Sam turned the car around and came and get me.
So just as he's ready to take you back.
He took me back.
He took you back, you started to cry.
After they told me they weren't taking
you. They weren't taking you.
Because they told me about living on a ranch with all the animals and all of this stuff. And it wasn't, and I was ready to run away from the orphanage anyway.
So he turned around, came back, picked you up, and took you back to Chula Vista.
Now, at the time, just so you know, right now, if you go on C Street, there are a bunch of apartments, the DMV, the whole valley, that was owned by the Shopoffs. They had one house which was up on top. I knew Leah Shopoff because my father used to take her home from the temple. But I wanted to know, was it like being a child of Leah and Sam Shopoff? Once you got past the fact that he turned around and picked you up, what was life like?
Well, it was good. I had no problems. I mean, I tell about it in my book. I came to the house, and one of Leah's sister, Jenny, was at the house cooking up the storm, and there were some other relatives. Estelle Dunst, you remember Estelle
Yes,
Dunst?
Of course.
Okay.
Oh my God, of course, and Lou Dunst.
Estelle Dunst was Leah's niece.
Oh Lord. So here you are, did you suffer any anti-Semitism when you were growing up in Chula Vista?
Yes, yes.
How?
C Street was a dirt road, and the house was here, and then there was a bunch of kraals and stuff where the cattle were. He was a cattle dealer.
Right.
And there was a hill there, and one day I walked up that hill, and there was some boy there. I don't remember who he was or what his name was, and he called me a dirty Jew.
In Chula Vista.
And I slugged him.
You hit him. You slugged
him. I hit him right in the face. I just...
And did he ever say that again?
I never saw him again.
Mazel tov.
Warner wrote a book, The Epitome of the American Dream. I highly recommend that you read this book. It's quite an incredible story.
I'm Renee Haber, and I'm a Holocaust survivor.
Renee Vogel Haber was in a horrific death camp, labor camp, slave camp, and survived. I believe she had her number removed. I believe the camp was Transnistria. She doesn't talk about her Holocaust experiences, but we're so grateful that we could count her in to include her as a person who survived the Holocaust and came to the South Bay. By the way, her grandson is the drummer for Nine Inch Nails, Alon Rubin. What is your definition of a Holocaust survivor? Well, a lot of people think that it's the Nazi regime, being in a camp, being in hiding. I remember interviewing a Holocaust survivor. She is a survivor. And I do this through the USC Shoah Foundation. She was 101 years old. And what's interesting is when I got the form, it asked me, well, she left to come to America in 1938. So if the camps and hiding and things took place between 1941 to 1945, how could she be a Holocaust survivor? Well, in 1938, the family had a meat market, and the Nazis came into the place of business and said to the father, "Do you see these meat hooks? I'm putting your family on those hooks." So immediately they got to a ship, they boarded a ship. They had family in Memphis, Tennessee, of all places, and they ended up coming to the United States. My next person that I feature is Ona Yufi. Now, although she was in the United States, she went to school in the morning. She was ridiculed and told that she was a dirty Jew by the Catholic school. Having to grow up with this kind of treatment is completely, completely outrageous, and it should never be accepted. Ona has a very interesting story. Ona married Jack Yufi, who had a twin brother by the name of Oscar Storr. Because of the family getting divorced, ended up going back to Germany. The mother placed him in the Nazi youth. Crazy, hmm? By 1954, Ona remembered being with Jack on a platform meeting Oscar. As Ona described it, she was standing next to Jack her husband, who was looking at the twin brother, who also could have been her husband. The two were able to communicate, but what was interesting, they looked absolutely identical, from almost the clothes to their mustache to their stature. Paul Schauder and his brother Jack and his mother Fanny came from Germany. They were in hiding. His older brother Hermann was killed in Auschwitz, and his father was arrested during Kristallnacht, and they had an egg farm. I remember as a child going to the egg farm, and the ranch was located at Sweetwater Road and 805, but because of eminent domain and the 805 freeway coming through, they moved. Ursula Izrelsky was a child in hiding. How do you remember something when you're 4 or 5 or 6 years old?
I was 3 when we left.
In 1939, Ursula Izrelsky and her mother fled from Germany to Belgium to hide from Nazis in an attic.
And I had a whooping cough, remember that? And my mom said, don't make noise, we're not supposed to make any noise.
They lived in that attic for 3 years.
In the middle of the night, and they knock on the door. They spoke German, say, aufmachen, aufmachen, open the door, open the door.
Her mother was taken to Auschwitz, and at the age of 5, Ursula bounced from one group home to the other, with no one to protect her.
When I was 8, I was taken to a private home in the countryside, and I got sexually abused, yeah.
Ursula's story, along with other survivors, is on display thanks to Sandy Scheller.
This is my mother. This is what she wore 2 days before going into the concentration camp.
Sandy's mother, Ruth, survived, and together they collected documentation from the Holocaust.
It talks about the fact that this Nazi woman admitted to what she did in Auschwitz.
The exhibit will remain in Chula Vista throughout 2020.
It speaks to the will of human survival.
Mayor Mary Salas shared the importance of remembering.
It's so easy for a government to incrementally make changes that people don't realize what's happening and the horrors that can happen if you're not paying attention to what's going on.
The exhibit is filled with pictures and proof because survivors say there is no greater insult than saying this didn't happen.
I listen, I swallow it, and I move on.
It's important.
As for Ursula, she found her mother at a hospital after the war.
She didn't have any hair. She weighed like 58 pounds, you know, and I was afraid to go over there.
Ursula's mother was taken to Switzerland, and she never got to say goodbye. Which is why she lives for moments like these.
Oh, I got a tattoo.
In the Sevely Zone, Jeff Sevely, News 8.
That's funny.
What was your false name?
Jacqueline Servais.
Jacqueline Servais.
Because it's French, you know.
Instead of Ursula Izrelsky.
And they told me, don't ever give your real name. You know, remember that.
Don't give your name.
Yeah, and it was hard. And then after the war, you could get your name back. And I forgot. I could remember my last name, actually. You know. Oh, my gosh.
So yeah. The invasion takes place. You have 1 hour, pack a suitcase. Yeah. Where did you go?
They took us. It was middle of the night, of course. And they took us to a big headquarters. I think it was a hangar.
Like an airplane hangar.
Like an airplane. It looked like, it may not have been, because it was quite a long ways, if I remember. Mm-hmm. And there's this huge building, and then they opened up the doors, and they took us inside, and there were hundreds of people inside already.
Hundreds of people.
Hundreds of people, sitting, laying, you know. And we just sat there, and my mom just held me, I guess. And in the morning, the doors opened up. And they say, everybody aufsteigen, aufsteigen. Everybody get up, everybody get up. And people were going outside, and there were army trucks all over, hundreds of army trucks. And they took people and said, go in a truck, go in a truck. So that's what they did. And they took my mom, and they didn't take me. That's the thing.
They
didn't take me.
Take your mom. You're standing.
I'm
in
standing
the
next
area,
to her.
Next to her.
Yeah.
They take her mom, who ended up in Auschwitz.
Yeah, yeah. Buchenwald, Auschwitz.
And there you are by yourself, age.
I was 5 then. It was 42.
Years old.
Yeah.
What does a 5-year-old do when you're standing on a platform? Your mother is gone. And how did you get from there?
I don't know.
To,
I never knew.
You never knew. Did you go back to your hiding place? Or
who
took you?
I have no idea. All I could see, they were taking my mom and I don't know if they separated the man with the women. She was in a truck and she was kind of going like this. And I waved. I didn't know what was happening.
Were you screaming, crying? Did you go, Mama, Mama?
I don't remember.
Oh my God. So
I don't remember.
You don't even know if somebody picked you up.
They must have.
They must have, obviously.
Yes, because I wound up in a small, my first orphanage.
You were in your first orphanage.
That's where your friend in Las Vegas was.
Yeah.
In Wesenbeck.
Yeah. Yes, Sabina.
Yes, so I don't know how I got there.
Here's somebody that I met in Las Vegas, Sabina.
Yes.
And Tony, her husband.
Yeah.
And when I first met you, and you're telling me you're from Belgium, I made it a point to call my friend in Las Vegas, who was in the same situation as Ursula.
We were in the same home.
In the same home.
5, 6 years old. And I didn't, of course, I didn't know it.
And she didn't know.
I didn't know.
And yet, here's Sabina living in Las Vegas.
It's the first person that I knew that was there. Except for my friends I grew up, because we were in different homes. We kept going different places because the Germans were getting close. And
how did you feel emotionally? Do you remember any of the emotions that you went through? Your mother's gone.
No.
You don't know where she is.
I don't know.
How did you find out that she went to Auschwitz?
I didn't know.
You didn't know?
I didn't know what it was. I have no idea. I was little. I didn't know what was going on. And when I wound up in Wesenbeck, there were lots of kids there too, my age, older.
Were you eating? Were you not eating?
Yes.
Did you like the meals? Were they nice to you?
I don't remember that.
Were they nice to you?
They weren't bad, but some places were horrible. They're sexually abusive and all that, you know. Oh, yeah. A lot of, and they didn't do nothing because in those days, nobody spoke.
You're how old?
Huh?
How old are you at this time?
When then?
Yes.
I was 6.
The other thing about Ursula, she's a volunteer here in our Chula Vista Public Library. I could not have done this without Mayor Mary Salas, our city council, who voted unanimously that this is an important exhibit. Of course, Joy Watley and Allison Hamlin from our Chula Vista Public Library, and our board members from Chula Vista Heritage Museum and South Bay Historical Society. Our president is Harry Orgavon. I'm vice president. Susan Johnson is our secretary. Mitch Beecham is our treasurer. And there's Patty Huffman, Cesar Castro, Peter Watry, and Dr. Zhivago, Marie Zhivago, on our board. Do stay tuned for exhibits that will be happening in our library. Our next exhibit after Ruth, Remember Us, the Holocaust, will be the Filipino America exhibit and how they discovered the South Bay. This will open up in October. Thank you so much for watching, and shalom.